you know, as many people who in the Northwest Territories, we have an opportunity to work at the national level, and he's done that very well with the Advisory Council of the Canadian Institute of Health Information's Population Health Initiative, as well as the Advisory Council of the National Collaborating Centers for Public Health. So he can speak not only to northern issues, but of course to issues right across the country. And his experience in Alberta, I'm sure, has brought him even further along the road of understanding where health is going in this country and how we can make a difference. So, Dr. Andrew Corvo, please.
Well, this on?
Is yours on?
Yes, well, thank you, Dennis. So I'm going to go quite quickly through my slides because I initially thought I had 20 minutes and now I'm down. But there's a few important things that I need to highlight in terms of you know, what's different about our healthcare system in the North and why some of the challenges that we face require particular attention. So I might have to move my slides. First of all, I wanted to mention that you know, we have regions in the Northwest Territories, so it's not like a uniform healthcare system, and we have to deal with issues of distance, dispersed population. There are 8 regional health authorities and a number of languages as well that impact on the setup of the system to recognize the cultural diversity and provide an opportunity for cultural safety in the design of our healthcare system. And I'm sure Sandra's going to want to talk about that a little bit more. I'm showing this slide because this has a very important impact on our healthcare system. You'll see there's a bulge here that's happened over the last decade and a half in terms of the aging of the population. So there's a very rapid change that has occurred between 1991 and 2010 in the number of people who are over the age of 40, and especially in this group here. So that has impact on some of the statistics you will see later with regard to cancer rates and other things that are associated with aging. Much of what I'm talking about is in a report that was published a year ago called the Northwest Territories Health Status Report. It was published in 2011. So that, you know, if you want more information, that's where you go and find it. These are some of the key findings. I'm going to skip this slide because I want to talk about some of the things that are actually improving with regard to life expectancy. It is something we still have a gap between NWT and Canada, which is explained by the premature deaths that are occurring here, but it is actually on an upward slope. So we are trying to catch up. So I'm going to take a look at a social lens on the health status, which looks first of all at determinants, then looks at lifestyle factors, so some of the risk factors, the screening activities, and the disease outcomes. One of the important aspects of health, of course, is associated with education. We know that throughout the world, the more educated people are, the more it has an impact on their ability to acquire new information, to get a good job, and it has a direct impact on health. And although there are still significant differences between our Yellowknife and our regional centers and the rest of the communities, there has, especially except for the small communities where we have it seems to be stagnating, there has been a general increase in the level of schooling that our population is benefiting from. The issue around income, big disparities again, the income is a huge factor with regard to health status, and big disparities there. And housing issues. We have, like I'll be talking about later, the issues around, for example, MRSA, which is a skin infection with a bacteria that is resistant to antibiotics. And so the overcrowding that may occur in certain communities has a big impact on the spread of diseases like MRSA or tuberculosis and other issues. So it's a big issue here in the north with regard to housing. And family violence is a big impact on early childhood development, for example. Looking at some of the health indicators or behavior indicators that the population that is overweight in our population is not drastically different from the rest of Canada, but it's an issue across the country. And where we have a huge difference with Canada is on the level of heavy drinking that is taking place in across the population, and certainly here there's again some regional differences, and that has an impact when you think about women in childbearing age, for example, and the relationship with the risk for FASD. It's quite significant that you have a lot of heavy drinking that is still going on. Smoking is a big issue here, and again, big disparities between Yellowknife and the rest of the population. I had some slides just about preventative behavior. So this is how many people had a blood pressure check. We know that high blood pressure is a risk factor for strokes, for heart disease, and very few people. So is it an issue around access of health care, or people don't understand that they need to get this done? That's an issue we're working on right now. And with regard to health outcomes now, life expectancy at birth has been, like I mentioned, it's been increasing, but we have still a big gap with the rest of Canada. The leading causes of death, cancer is now the top cause of death here in the north. And this is an issue that's going all across the circumpolar world, actually, from Alaska to Greenland. Major cause of mortality as compared to Canada. So with regard to our cancer rates, they're not significant. You know, they're still, they're a little bit above the Canadian average, but probably not significantly so at this point. But in terms of cardiovascular deaths and injury and respiratory disease, we are way above the Canadian average. And then again, the differences between our small communities. So the big gap, of course, is around injury, which affects younger people, and respiratory diseases, in part because of the high rates of smoking and use of tobacco within the home that affects the health of children as well. With regard to hospitalizations for mental illness, the substance abuse and related disorders are certainly the big component and certainly a preventable component of the cost of our mental health system. Lost my slides. Anyway, I must have just scroll down. Anyway, for the context of brevity, I just wanted to emphasize that some of the issues that we face are quite unique. And I mentioned that we've had a steady rise in the rates of cancer in the north. In part, it's attributable to the increase in the age of our population overall, because the cancer is associated with aging across the world. But we have some features of our cancer rates that are quite significant, in part because cancer rates used to be very low in our Aboriginal communities because of traditional diets. And so the changes in lifestyle that have taken place have had big impacts on the rates of cancer. And for example, colorectal cancer, which used to be 25 years ago when I started to work in the north, was very low. Right now, in some of our communities, there are three times the national average. and the colorectal cancer is very significantly linked to things like obesity, lack of physical activity, and the changing diet. Mm-hmm. So those three factors explain the very rapid rise, and that rise has been noticed from, like I said, from Alaska to Greenland, and all the circumpolar communities are having to deal with this issue as well. Our cancer rates are also elevated because of the links with the tobacco smoking as well. So anyway, there seems to be a glitch with the presentation, but that's pretty much my overview, and I've used my 10 minutes anyway, so I'll stop now and I'll pass it to Sandra.